Hi everybody, thank you for coming to the second video. So the next three videos will be about the clinical exam only. So Thomas here will do some tests on the patient. We'll take three times the same guy. The previous video, the one from last week, will be online by 10 days, something like that. If you have any question, put them straight on the chat of the conversation, okay? Because there is kind of a 1 minute ping between what you see and what we're doing. So just to be sure that we're not going to miss your question at the end. Let's go.
Yeah.
Thank you, Thomas.
So, hi, everyone. Like Laurent explained, we're going to focus on the clinical examination today and the next two webinars. So we're focused on the next three webinars. One with, so we decided to take the same patient, with the three webinars, but we will cut the clinical examination on three parts. So today will be anamnesis and table examination on the table. And the next time it will be clinical examination on static and dynamic. And the next time, one more time, it will be press-cam analysis, testing the different correction, and how to communicate. The last part will be how to communicate with the patient, with the doctors, and how to prepare the insults you are going to make. So we decided to take one patient and cut in three parts for you to be able to ask as many questions as possible. We decided to do like this instead of taking one patient and do everything at the same time, like 1 hour all the clinical examination. It's also possible, but it's quite fast, a lot of information. And in general, by experience, we focus only on one pathology. So we prefer to cut in three parts, have more time to discuss, even if it's not in live. I mean, it's live video, but not in live physically. The goal is to exchange a bit some information to make a bit more alive. So we decided to cut in three parts like this to be able to talk about as many pathology as possible and give as many information as possible to you guys for you to be able to work in your cabinet straight after the movie. Okay, so why to take care of the clinical examination? You know that it should be every time the same process, more or less, with the same more or less steps during the clinical examination. And the first steps, two first steps, is anamnesis. It's really important step in your cabinet. Usually it's taking, let's say, 15 minutes approximately in your cabinet. And the next step will be clinical examination on the table. And the next step, and so on and so on. And it's like an investigation, let's say. So you have one patient, you take some information during the anamnesis, then you take some information during the examination on the table, and so on and so on. Every step, you have some information from the step before. It's a kind of investigation, let's say. So we will welcome our patient for today, Alexander.
Hi, everybody.
So he's completely out from the food care analysis.
Of course.
So, hi, Alexander.
Hi.
So the first question you should ask in your cabinet, it's not like why you are coming or where do you have pain or something basic like this. No, you should start with who talked about the cabinet. Like, is it the osteopath who explained, who said like you should go to see Mr. Arnaud? Is it the doctors? Is it the physio? Is it one patient? Is it? It's really important information for your stats. You do a bit of
prescriber.
Stats. Yeah, prescriber. Is it just online? He searched the information online. Is it the doctors, physio, osteopath, and so on? It's really, if you want to develop a bit your cabinet, it's an important information, I should say. So in that case, it's a bit different, but you should start a question like this. Of course, when you go search to the waiting room, the patient, you already start the clinical examination. When you take the patient, you make him walk in front of you with the shoes to the cabinet. And you check already the steps, and you will save a bit of time at the end. So it's the first steps is here, more or less. And then, my let's say, really classic information, no
really big things interesting in that, like the name, address, and so on and so on. This is really classic. And then you go a bit deeper. So the first question, like I said, it's not like where, why do you come? You start with a bit the history, let's say. So did you have a past injury before? So you can start with the injury, and then you move forward with some different question, but you start with basic information like that. After the classic data, so we will start with the past injury. Okay. Did you have some past injury before?
Yeah, it was about 10 years ago. I had like, I broke my my shin bone.
Okay.
And it was while I was skiing. So
okay.
Yeah, it was 10 years ago. Otherwise, nothing special.
Okay, so one fracture on tibia.
Tibia
here, during skiing. So during skiing, did you have the surgery on it?
Yeah, surgery. So it took about maybe 1 year because I had to. So it was like put some.
Metal.
Yeah, exactly. And they had to remove it 1 year after. So
okay,
took a bit of time.
One year off.
Yeah.
One year off.
Yeah.
You could do some sports still during this period.
Between the first year, it was like maybe 3 or 4 months after, but only a little, like not with a big impact and stuff. So it was just for maybe 6 or 7 months, and then I had to remove the metal parts. In my chin bone, so it was another maybe three or four months without any sports.
Without any sports.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Apart from this, you had some past injury also, like stress fractures or ankles.
No, not as bad as the fracture, but I had sometimes, and I still have some pain on my knee, on my left knee.
Okay.
Especially when I'm running. After a while, after maybe 6 or 7K, I'm like, I feel some pain in my knee.
Okay, so yeah, just to move on a bit, you can ask about the past injury and then also about past muscles pain at the same time. So it's also nice information to have. If you have, for example, I don't know, some triceps pain, always the same size and same side since many years, it's also nice information to have in your cabinet. The goal is to have many information, and you will fix your clinical examination depending on this information every step, so you will save time. So we started with past injury information. You could start also with activity. Activity, what is it? It's professional activity and also sports activity, of course. And you have to precise a bit these activities. So we can start with the professional activities. What kind of job it is, and is it always at the office? Is it always traveling? Is it driving a car? Is it a standing position with a lot of movement like this? You have to precise a bit everything like this, and which kind of shoes also you have during the walk.
I would say it's like a mix between standing and sit down working on the office. So it's like about 50-50,
50-50
on the percentage.
Yeah.
And I'm working as a business developer, so it's sometimes I just on the road, and most of the time travel outside the country. And otherwise, yeah, I'm working at the office, but most of the time right now I'm working while I'm standing up. So
okay. It's
just not the position like sitting all the time. And I try to keep moving.
Okay, so it's a nice way of working, let's say. So it's important really to ask this question at the beginning, because if you have some information like, okay, during this strange period with COVID and so on, I work a lot in the home office. I was not used to work at the home office. I don't have a nice office at home, so I'm in a bad position. And because of that, maybe I have some knee pain, pain on the head or cervical neck pain or something like this. You have to ask such question to have a bit more precision on everything. So in that case, it's about a bit of everything. That's 50-50, let's say. So
yeah. It's
quite polyvalent and no big problems I see in that situation. And what about the sports?
doing quite several sports. The principles were now like the running, cycling, and also doing some upper body,
fitness,
gym with calisthenic. So yeah, it's
cross training
and stuff like that.
Okay. So when you have such a sportsman, you have to precise a bit about the sports. So let's precise and start about the running. So running, as you know, it can be trail running, it can be running on the road, it can be running a bit polyvalent, mixed, and how many kilometers and how many times per week. Because sometimes you can have one runner who said, okay, I run just a bit. And when you ask, he do 100K per week. So it's a lot. And the opposite situation, I do a lot of running. And when you ask, it's only 5-10 kilometers and one time per week. So you have to precise and ask a bit these questions. So what about running? Which kind of track?
Yeah, about the frequency, it's about three times. The average, it's about three times a week.
Yeah.
Yeah, per week. And most of the time on trail, not on road, on the
not
beach.
On road, yeah.
So
trail running
most of the time, three times a week. And the distance is about, I would say the average 10K.
10K, okay, 10K, three times per week, and on the trail. So you know that on trail running, so it's running in a mountain, basically. Mm-hmm. So you have less impact, but you have more instability on the track, because you have some rocks, you have some wood, dirt, slippery sometimes, so the steps less stable, but less impact also. So it's important to know such information because it can create some pathology different than some pathology doing running on the road simply. Okay, so this is nice. And what about the bicycle?
Bicycle most of the time on road, so it's road cycle.
Okay.
About during the season, especially during the
spring
or summer season, I'd say 60K per week once.
Okay.
One time per week.
60K.
Yeah.
Okay. And you have, I think you have fixed position on the pedal?
Yeah. I have a fixed position because it's like a specific bike, you know, on the road. So it's like you can't move your feet while you are cycling. Yeah.
So it's you do not have a lot of degrees of mobility.
No.
So okay. So when you have such a situation, and if you have, I don't know if it's the case or not yet, but if you have knee pain during the cycling, and the first thing to do is to try to open a bit the mobility on the pedals. So we know that we have some different colors on the pedals, and some colors have a bit more mobility. So if you just open up a bit the mobility, it will be more natural, the pedals, and it will be the knee in a better position, let's say. You can start like this. If you have knee problems during the cycling and knee problems during the running, of course, it's impossible to make only one pair. Why? Because it's really different steps. Mm-hmm. Because when you run, your feet basically, it will move a lot. So go down, go up, go down, go up, like to be able to absorb the shock absorption. Mm-hmm. And during cycling, it's opposite. So you have fixed position like this, your pedal. But if you have a lot of movement, you lose a bit of energy.
Mm-hmm.
So it's better if you have a fixed position on the feet. So the insoles will be automatically different. So if you check the catalog, Podiatek catalog, if you check the opacity running and you compare to the opacity bike, it's really different. You have something with a lot of more rigidity, and you have to be fixed position during cycling. And when you run, it's opposite. You need some mobility. So it's impossible to make only one pair. So in your situation, if you want to improve, to be more efficient during cycling, you will need also one pair for the cycle. For the bike.
It's not
possible to make only one pair in such a situation. Okay, so about the sports activity, we did some precision. We talked about the professional activity.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about the past injury.
Mm-hmm.
So now we have more information about this. We know, we can keep in mind that he had past injury on the left, on the tibia. And now we can discuss about why he came to the cabinet, why he came to me. Do you have any pain?
I have still pain, I would say, every day when I just wake up at the lower part of the back. Yeah. And afterwards, I do some like mobility routine in order to get better. But I have still every day the pain in my on my lower back. Otherwise, yeah, as I said, on my left knee,
okay,
it's quite, especially not every day. It's only when I'm like doing some sports after 6 or 7K, especially when I'm running. It's getting on the front part.
Yeah, tired.
Otherwise, it's
okay. So when you have the goal, like the goal of about the visit, you have to precise a bit. Let's start with the knee. He said, "I have pain in the knee." You have to precise a bit when you have pain and where and since how many times, like how long ago it happened. So you had pain since how many months or years?
About 3 years. Yeah, because 2 or 3 years. It's not specially linked to the fracture.
Okay,
it's, I'd say, more link about when I've done a trail, kind of a big trail, and it's happened once, and then for maybe 3 or 4 months afterwards, the trail, I had the big pain on my left knee.
Okay.
It was getting better, you know, with the time, but I have still like the same pain on my knee even today, but it's not a big pain, you know. I can still run. I can still cycle. Yeah.
It's something you feel.
Yeah, exactly.
When you do during the activity.
Exactly.
Only not after or before. It's doing.
Exactly.
Doing.
Correct.
So you have to precise this, because if it's one pain at the morning, for example, if you have pain at the morning, it's it can be tendon pain. When you have pain during the activity, it can be linked to the bad movement during the activity or lack of stability during the activity. So it's also interesting to ask such question. One things we forgot to ask, it's also about the equipment for the sports. So did you make a change on the shoes recently?
It was about 1 year ago. Now I changed for minimalist running shoes.
Okay.
So, but I've done that step by step.
Okay.
No, not a big change. At the beginning, I was more walking.
Okay.
A short distance, and then running short distance, and then you know, increase the distance of the run. But it was step by step, and I won't say it's linked to the pain on my knee, because it was before and it's still there. So yeah.
Okay. So he said like such a big change. We can show, have such shoes now. So it's we will talk a bit deeper during the next webinar about the shoe analysis.
Before
it was like this. So with quite a lot of reinforcement inside the shoes, and with high drop, let's say, and now he decided to run on such a minimalist shoe, so with no drop, it's flat and way less reinforcement inside. So he said he did step by step. Still 1 year is quite short.
Yeah.
So to make such changements, we advise to go even deeper in the step by step process. So let's say it takes in general about 2 years to open up such shoes and to run with such shoes. So maybe it was a bit too fast.
Okay.
But if we make special insoles for such shoes, as possible, of course, the transition between the two kind of shoes will be faster and easier also for you. So don't forget, even if you run with such shoes, you can make orthotics inside, of course, molded orthotics, because the transition between the changement in the shoes will be faster, easier for the patient. Because the goal at the end for him is to have, let's say, lighter running process, so you have less impact, so potentially less trauma. But it's more difficult and more demanding for the muscles. When you have such transition, you need more tonicity
And potentially, if you have some pain on the muscles, it can be also because of that, because it was a bit too fast. Maybe. For the moment, it's only supposition, but it's really important when you talk about the sport to talk about the equipment at the sport. Because if you play football, for example, on a synthetic surface,
yeah,
you will have way more impact. So if you do not have the nice shoes for such track, let's say, you will have some pain maybe because of the shoes, not because of the insoles. So it's important really to talk about this equipment at the sport. Okay, so now we can come back to the why he came to the cabinet. So he talked about the knee pain and also about the low back pain. Low back pain is a bit every day, you said.
Yeah. It's frequent. Every day, at the morning, especially when I'm standing up like this for a while, I start to feel like some pain on my low back. I don't know if it's like more on the left or on the right side, to be honest. Yeah. It's quite equal.
It can be moving maybe one time on the left, one time on the right.
Sometimes
a bit central.
Exactly.
It's not fixed at one point, let's say.
Okay. And I'm practicing kind of a lot of morning routine. Yeah.
Stretching.
Stretching in order to feel better. And that works, but I know that I have something, deeper and something to solve.
Okay. And what about the knee? Is it in the front?
Definitely.
Okay. Front. So when the patient talked about knee pain, you have to ask the question, is it more on the front, on the back, or lateral part, like medial or lateral? Of course, you will go deeper during the analyze, but if you know at first the approximate position, the next step will be easier for you. And then you continue the scanning process, basically scanning process. So he come for knee and the low back. Okay, but why not to ask different position also? Maybe he have also one pain, he didn't tell. So I will ask like, and start by the feet. Like basically, do you have also any pain on the feet and ankle?
No.
So feet and ankle, no problem, but you have to ask. You move a bit up, so what about the right knee?
No, it's quite good. Yeah.
And you move up one more time, so about the hip and the low back, we discussed already, so you move up a little bit more, so between scapula, or...
Sometimes on the left part here,
okay.
I feel like a bit of pain.
Yeah. A bit of pain between the shoulders?
Yeah, here, just a bit.
Okay, so you know that when you have such pain between, like, let's say, between, I don't know this bone in English, but between these big bones of the shoulder and the back, most of the case, it's when you have some movement like this, or when you walk with your hand, or so. I don't talk specially about Alexander, but when you talk about all the patients in general, when you have pain between shoulders like this, most of the case it's because you have manual maybe jaw and you have maybe some conflict in this movement. So maybe you did some sports also before with this kind of movement or not really.
Yes, but maybe
tennis or something.
Fitness, yeah. Still fitness, I think. But not specially. When I'm doing like some, something and I'm using my hands to do something. And as you said, it's like when I'm doing something, not only standing up, but when I'm doing something with my hand, I start to feel pain.
Okay. Yeah. And then you move up one more time. And we're going to talk about the neck. If you have maybe head pain also, and you don't feel comfortable on the head or something like this, or about the neck, something like that.
No, not really.
Okay, so now we know why he came to us. Like he came for the knee. He do some running, bicycle, a bit of swimming. Yeah. And so basically triathlon style. And he have knee pain during the running process, not during cycling process, but running process. And low back pain, mostly at the morning before the stretching. Okay, so he came for that. And what I wanted to say something before to move back to the clinical examination on the table. Also, you know that even if you don't have a postural training, but all the deviation a bit more precise,
you know that you must have a global analyze. So global analyze, what does that mean? We know that if you have deviation or difference between eyes, between ears, or between even teeth or body problems or stuff like this, it will create also some strange postural deviation that you won't understand everything. So if you ask the question before, you will save time afterward. Because if I ask one basic question like, okay, yeah, I forgot to say, I don't see from one eye. If I don't see from one eye, I will move a bit my head like this to, in a way, to see better with these eyes. So it will change my position. So if you will, maybe you will observe some deviation, not really logical, but you know why it's not logical, because you have a deviation on the head. Mm-hmm. So this kind of question, and most of the case we forgot to ask, and the patient forgot to tell you, because he doesn't want to come to the cabinet and say, okay, I want insults, but I don't see from one eye. Forget this. Yeah. He will never send the information to you.
Sure.
So you have to ask. So no problems?
Actually, no.
Eyes, teeth, ears, or something about digestion, or something like this. Okay, so this is really an important step. And the last step before to go to the table, it will be, do you have any treatments? Do you have any treatment with osteopath in the past, since how many times? Do you have physiotherapy? Do you have medicine with some pills, drugs, and stuff like this? Because you know that we have some pills also with bad, how to say it, secondaire, I don't know.
Bad effect.
Yeah. Bad effect because of the medicine. Sometimes you can have some tendinitis or stuff like that, or knee pain, or because of the medicine. So you must ask if you have some, even here we have a young patient with a young sportsman, but if you have an older person, you must ask also about the big pathology, diabetes, blood circulation, polyarthritis rheumatosis, big pathology like this. It's of course not the case for him, but you never know. So you have to ask a bit of some clinical disease or stuff like this. Did you have osteopath or chiropractor recently?
Osteopath, chiropractor, it was about 2 years ago. So
yeah,
but it was 2 years ago. I had a lot of things to do.
Yeah,
2 years ago. But I haven't been to the chiropractor since that date. Otherwise, yeah, nothing special. No treatments. Even no physiotherapist. And
okay. So, yeah. And you are 25 years old. Yeah.
28. I would.
You look younger than me.
Cool. Thanks so much.
Okay, so now we have all the information in mind. So he's doing sports, mostly runnings and bicycle, have knee pain on the front of the knee, low back pain, and an injury on the left leg, and no recent osteopath or chiropractor. So we know that if we see something, a lack of mobility, for example, maybe we can advise him to go back to the physio or go back to the osteopath. Don't forget that, like me, I work in a medical house, so I'm used to work with a lot of different professions. And as you can see now in France and also in Europe and also in a lot of countries in the world, it's more and more multidisciplinary, let's say. So if I don't have the answer, or if I have only one part of the answer, I have to advise him, like, you should go to the physio, you should go to the osteo, you should go to chiropractor, sports doctors or something. You have to be complete today, let's say. So, you can change yourself. Yeah. And we're going to see together about the table examination. So if at the end of the anamnesis, it's really important to sum up the situation to the patient, just to control if you understood well the situation with him. So you sum up with simple words, and you fix your situation, let's say. And so at this step, I advise you to go back to your laptop and feed the information. So I'm gonna use this board here. So all the basic information we can keep in mind before the next step, the clinical examination on the table. It's what? Like sports? So, run. What else? We have injury.
bigger injury on left. What else? We have low back pain. Low back pain, and that's it. So running, injury on the left, and knee on the left. So basically, we have to focus our clinical examination on the left side. Why? Because we had a past injury. So we have to control if you have lack of mobility on this leg, or yes or no. And we have to control also about the potentially deviation you can have on the back. Okay. So this was the first important information I keep in mind before the next step. Don't forget, it's a kind of an investigation. So every step, you have some basic information you will keep in mind for the next step afterward. Okay, so you will move on your back, please. Okay, just the feet like this. Okay, so to have a clinical table examination, it's a must today. Why? Because you have some control elements, some mobility, stuff like this, that you have to control before the next step. The next step, what is it? It's clinical examination on a static position. Okay, so before the static position, you have to control some information on the body, straight on the body. Okay, so you can start with the mobility. So maybe you can come a bit closer, Laurent, please. So you can start with the mobility. What does that mean? Basically, you don't have to be an osteopath or physio. I know that some countries, like in Poland or like in some countries, you are also physio, so you know all the mobility, so it will be easier for you. But it's not the case for everyone. If you have just the, let's say, basic knowledge for the beginners, it's easier. You just take all the mobility and you check if you have difference between left and right. This is the most basic information. You don't have to measure with precision all the angles and stuff like this. No, you check if you have difference between left and right, and mostly when you have a past injury like this. So, mobility like this. So you push on the feet, so you have approximately the same mobility on the left and right. So I move on. If I have no difference, I move on. I just control. I can try also the mobility like that. It has to be more than 90 degrees. So it's more than 90 degrees, and I control if I have the same things on the opposite ankle. So it's about the same. Then I take the heel. I take the forefoot, and I try my mobility. I go fast. I don't have to measure everything. Just I try to feel if I have the difference between left and right. And here it's not the case. Then I can explain also on the feet like this. You have to know approximately all the bones, of course. You have the first met here. You need to have mobility like this because it's really important during the steps when you run and when you walk. You have also, you need mobility. But this joint is really important. It's between cuboid and styloid here. So if you take on the feet the cuboid and you move the cuboid, if it doesn't move, if it's painful, it's not normal, mostly if it's one side. So if he didn't see an osteopath or chiropractor the last 2 years and you see a pain here and a lack of mobility, it's always good if you have someone in your address on your laptop, you can send the patient to this guy to check the mobility. And he will send you back some of the patient later. So it's a win-win deal, let's say. You work together with another profession and it's more efficient for the patient. So it's really important steps to control. So here, no big difference. I can move easily. It's not painful. So I'm okay with that. Of course, you can start with the most basic information, the skin quality. Also here today, it's a young sportsman, so we don't have a big problems. But if you have over skin, hyperkeratosis, the name, technical name,
or if you have plantar problems, or if you are a foot care specialist, you know better than me, such the skin problems. This is not the case. Of course, if you have also older patients, you have to control the blood circulation, and ask also the sensibility. We have also some equipment in the catalog, so equipment like this. I don't know if you can see in a proper way, but you can make some small impact, and you try different point for the sensibility. So for him, Alexander, today it's not a must, of course, but if you have a diabetic person or stuff like this, you have to control. So basically you ask the patient to close his eyes and check different point to check if he feel the feet or not. So this is really important when you have diabetic patient, because if he doesn't feel anything, you must be careful about the shoes, about the insoles, the materials you will use, and so on and so on. So for him, of course, I won't do anything, but for other kind of patient, you have to ask such question. It's important. Okay, so now we can move. We controlled all the mobility about the foot and ankle. We didn't see big problems at this step. Now we're gonna try to precise the pain on the knees. Where it is? Is it on the forefoot? No, not forefoot, but in the front part. Sorry, or is it in the back part? Is it on lateral? You have to precise a bit the pain here. Okay, when you control the knees, you know that we have tuberosis here on the tibia bone, and as you can see on the movie, I think you can see if you move a bit the movie, the webcam. Sorry. It's a bit bigger here than there. So maybe he had during the growth at 10 years old, something 12 years old, something like this. Did you had pain a bit about the knees?
Yes.
Yes, and mostly maybe on the left, as you remember, or yes. Maybe a long time ago, but.
Yeah, it was a long time ago, so I don't remember quite well, but I remember I had something on the
because
back.
You know such a pathology, Osgood Schlatter, the name is, it's when you grow a bit too fast and you make some sports with a lot of shock absorbed, like football or sports like this. You have in 2 points, you have also sever on the heel there. And you have Osgood Schlatter, the name, the same things on the knee. So when you see it's a bit bigger here, and bigger also, and it's the case a bit on the heel, he had most of the, I think so, it's not sure, but I think he had such a, let's say, pathology during the grow process. So over pressure, let's say, over inflammation at these 2 points. So now we have also pain on the left. So I see the problems here, mostly on the left. So when I think it's not painful when I touch by now, it's during the activity mostly.
Yeah.
So it's linked because here was a past injury during the grow process. And now the inflammation, it's at the same point. So it's the first big information you can see during these steps. Okay, I advise you, like I did just before, because we did the same movie in French before. So you can put with a pen or with some stickers, you can put one mark at the center of the patellos, because it will help you during the next step, the static analyze. So one cross at the center and one cross at the center and the opposite, or you can put some stickers also as you want. So now when I did that, I will did the palpation analyze. So I will ask him to bend your knees like this, move up your pelvis. Thank you. One more time, please. Okay. And then you can see if you have potentially difference between legs. As you know, so maybe some of you are also physio. Of course, when you do such a check, I see no difference. It's not a real difference between legs. It's just to give you one information. So you have to control also some mobility.
I will show you. If you bend your leg like this, you turn out, go back. I can do it one more time if you want.
Yeah, do it.
Yes. Bend, turn out, and go back. I see now a difference between legs. Of course, it's force, just one joint who moved. So it's a bit, seems to be a bit longer on the left. See if you do the same thing. But in medial part like this, you come back. And now it's longer. So what does that mean? If you have at first a small difference, you will do these two movements on the same leg and see if it's moving or not. What does that mean? If you have mobility on the pelvis, or if you don't have mobility on the pelvis. It's really simple test to do in your cabinet to just eliminate, let's say, one risk. Like if you have lack of mobility on the pelvis, if it's moving, it's okay. If it's not moving, it's not okay. So if it's not moving, you just send the patient to a chiropractor or osteopath or something like this. Okay. Now I will move a bit and do a bit more test. So Laurent, if you can please come a bit closer with the webcam. Thank you. So now the goal will be to try different muscles to check if it's painful or not. So I try with the hallux flexor first. There, so I push on the muscles and he will tell me if it's painful or not. Okay?
Yeah.
Same thing about the aponeurosis here. Not painful. And I do the same on the opposite feet. Why I have to check all the time? Because sometimes you can have a bit of pain and he doesn't feel it during the activity, but he feels it when I push on it. I can do the same about fibular muscles. There. Nothing. Tibial posterior muscles. Nothing at all, also. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, okay.
I go a bit faster. And then I can do the same about the tibia here and the tibial anterior here. So this is the muscles, this is the bone. How do you feel?
No, it's all
right. A little bit more painful on the left than the right?
A bit more on the left, yeah.
A bit more on the left. A bit more on the left, what does that mean? That means you have a bit of inflammation on the bone here on the left. It's quite logical because he had a past injury on it. So if you have a kind of activity with a lot of shock or something like this, like running, it's a bit kind of inflammation on the bone on the left side. So it's quite logical by the past trauma. And about muscles on lateral, no big problems. Then you move to the knee. It's very important to check this kind of information, mostly on the runners, because on the runners, you have a lot of pathology on the knees. So you have to check the knees. So on the back, you have one muscles. I forgot the name in English, but it's one muscles who cross the knee and he's doing stability on the knees. So if it's painful about one knee, that means that the knees and the ankle is potentially a bit unstable.
Yeah, I can feel it.
You can feel it here.
Oh, yes.
What is the French name?
Poplité in French.
Poplité.
Maybe you can search on the end.
Sometimes
at first. Yeah, this part here.
Okay, and it's a bit more painful on the left,
Yeah.
So, I don't want to push too much because apparently it's quite painful. So what does that mean? That means you have maybe a lack of stability on the left. It's quite logical also because of the past injury. Here, also, you can check muscle insertion here in the medial part and here in the lateral part. If you feel some pain, you know that for the running process, you have a lot of patients with pain here on medial, but apparently no big deal, no big problems.
And here, I don't think so.
No.
A bit here, maybe.
Yes.
So it's all about muscles, of course. So you have to check on your books and learn all the different muscles and go and search if it's painful or not. So basically, what we can sum up here, no big difference of mobility on the feet and the ankles, a bit of inflammation on the tibia, and I can remember sensibility about the patellar tendon here, with a past pathology about the tuberosity of the tibia here on the left. And it's more painful, the famous muscles who work for the stability. So my goal now for the next step, not next week, but the week after together, will be to control the stability of the left leg and to control a bit also the position of the pelvis, because we didn't see a big deviation yet about the low back pain. So on the next step, on the static position, I will have to control the static position of the pelvis, and on dynamic, what I will have to control, basically the stability of the left leg. So if I keep in mind for today, the information I will have to control for the next two steps will be the next two steps, static and dynamic. It will be on static, the position of the pelvis, and on dynamic, is it stable steps on the left because of the trauma. So I have all the information in mind for today, and the next steps I will control depending on this information. So do not forget to, I think we explained more or less everything. So if I forgot some information, of course, you can ask me on the live and I will answer as much as I can the different questions live. And if you have some question later during the week, of course, you can send an email to Laurent at winter@sidas.com. And if he can answer, he will answer, or he will transfer me the mail and I will answer during the week. No problems. So at the end of this, okay, I think we had all the information. So if I put a new page with more information here, what I can remember for next time, it's tibia inflammation and patella tendon on the left. So on the left also, so basically I have a lot of information to check on the left leg, and I would have to control also the pelvis position in a static. So I hope it was clear information for all of you, and do not hesitate if you have any question. Maybe you want to give a word before to...
Yeah, thank you very much for coming. I will share with the same mailing list the videos, so we will put them on YouTube, on the SIDAS Academy channel, and on the extranet. Next week, it's the 4th, not next week, in 2 weeks. It's going to be the 4th of December. Okay, same time, if I remember well. Nothing more. Have any questions on the chat? Don't think so.
No. I think it will be a bit later.
Okay.
So
thank you very much.
See you next time. Thank you to all of you. And
we hope to see you in 2 weeks.
Yeah.